Father, again, as we do each week, we thank you for a brilliant opportunity that we have to be generous with what you have poured into us financially. We give it back, Father, as an act of worship, as an act of compassion, and as an act of desiring to see your kingdom come through this place here. In Jesus' name, amen. So we let it be a declaration. If you're feeling well and if you're feeling like on top of your game, then it is just a praise. If you're feeling like you're in a darker valley, it is a declaration of faith. Maybe they're both declarations of faith that we can declare before our Father in heaven that he is in control, that there is a road, and he has given me everything I need to walk upon it and to see me to come to that place of abundance of life. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to have a seat. And before Rochelle comes up and gives us a Bible reading, last night a bunch of us were at Spirit and Grace, and I've asked Lisa, who was there, and I've asked her to just give you an understanding of what either she felt God did, or what she saw God did, or just how she felt about it. So if you just want to grab, maybe with Lily's microphone over there, that would be good.
Hello. So last night was pretty cool. I think it was probably the fourth one that's been around. I just really encourage you all, if you haven't been or if you've only been to a couple, I think that, you know, come. It was really, really good. So it was good because you got to hang out with other churches and talk to, you know, kindred spirits and people who were on the same journey that we're on. Also, it was really cool because we get to hang out with each other, you know, like I got to have dinner with Michael and Victor and Naomi and Matt and stuff and just get to know them better. So in that sense, it's really beneficial too. But I also think for me personally, when I think about Spirit and Grace, the word that I think about is unhindered. And when I'm there, I don't feel like it just feels like the most simple thing in the world, you know, just to clear your night and have that little space with God. It was just so simple. And everybody else there is like just expressing how they love God and what they feel and what they're learning. And for me, it was a really, it sort of helped spurs me on to reach further and believe for more. And, you know, people there were being healed of different things and bringing different issues to God and you know, leveling their playing fields in different ways. And I think it was just, it's great to be around those people because it just helps me with my everyday, I think. So next time, if you want to come and you're not coming because maybe you don't know anyone or, you know, it's a little bit intimidating or daunting, maybe just, you know, I'll have dinner with you. Come and hang out.
Okay. So Lisa will have dinner with you. That's a great invitation, right? That's an awesome invitation. I just noticed Alicia's up the back there. I didn't see you before, Alicia. Hope I didn't embarrass you about your butter chicken. Absolutely amazing. Rochelle, come on down and read to us.
The reading for today is Hebrews 7:15-22. And all of this is made even clearer if there was another king priest raised up with the rank of Melchizedek. This king priest did not arise because of a genealogical right under the law to be a priest, but by the power of an indestructible resurrection life. For it says in the Psalms, "You are like Melchizedek, a king priest forever." The old order of priesthood has been set aside as weak and powerless. For the law has never made anyone perfect, but in its place is a far better hope, which gives us a confidence to experience intimacy with God. And he confirmed to us with his solemn vow, for the former priests took their office without an oath, but with Jesus, God affirmed his royal priesthood with his promise, saying, "The Lord has made a solemn oath, and will never change his mind. You are a king priest forever. So all of this magnifies the truth that we have a superior covenant with God than what they experienced, for Jesus himself is its guarantor.
Thank you, Rochelle. Yeah, have you ever tried to do anything perfectly? Has it worked for you? Ever? Like, sometimes it's got to work out for you, right? It depends what your version of perfect is as well. And a few weeks ago, we spoke about that word perfect in the Bible. And if you go back into the language of the Greek, it means to be complete, to use it to its full purpose. It's used perfectly. And that's why the Bible can speak over you and call you to be perfect, not at your own level of understanding of perfect, but of God's. Isn't that cool? And so again, it is the Father in heaven who calls us, not we call each other perfect. He declares that over our lives. Are we happy with that this morning? The last 3 months we've been going through this book of Hebrews, which the further I go through it, the more that I am enjoying it. About 3 months ago, I landed a phrase on you guys, how the Word of God and through Hebrews, it's building one truth upon another truth, which leads to a greater truth, and that truth is actually Jesus. And so over the last 3 months, we've looked at things like life and love and hope. We've looked at things like family and unity. We've looked at rest, okay? The concept of rest in Scripture, of making yourself at home. And again, it's that phrase rest is something that's resonated in many of your hearts, because many of you have spoken to me about desiring to know what it is to make yourself at home. We've spoken about promise. We've spoken about this incredible guy with the strange name of Melchizedek, which means righteousness, and he rules a kingdom of peace. And there's this guy, Abraham, who's known as the blessing to many nations, meets the king of righteousness and peace on the road. And the thing that occurs on the road is a party, a feast. It's a beautiful picture in your mind, if you can actually allow your imagination to go to that place, to see a guy who is known as righteousness. His relationship with God is what people know him by. You meet a guy like that who rules a kingdom of peace and a guy who is a blessing to many nations. They connect on that road and all of a sudden a feast happens. Melchizedek invites him and blesses him and they sit down and share a meal together. Wouldn't you love to know what the conversation was at the table when you got a guy who's known by his relationship with the Father in heaven, who rules a kingdom of peace, meets the guy who is a blessing to many nations? You could only imagine what the conversation was like if they all spoke at that level. Temptation is to speak at a shallow level of how's the weather. It's good. It's nice, isn't it? There's not much more to say. It's nice. Can we move on? Like, can we actually go deeper than that? And I'm sure that whatever that conversation was at that road all those years ago, 3,500 years ago, where righteousness and peace meets blessing, I just can't imagine what that happened at that table. But you know what? It can happen today. It can happen today. And so a couple of weeks ago when I spoke about the power of your name and understanding who you are and understanding your identity, and when someone who serves God meets somebody who is of nobility and meets somebody who is of strength and of the rock, then all of a sudden if those three people are willing to speak at the deep level of their identity, before you know it, you have an awesome conversation that's actually occurring because it's centered on Jesus and they're speaking from the very real parts of their hearts and of their lives. It's not hard. It's just being vulnerable. And some people say that to me, that's really, really hard. I want to say to you, it can be if you talk yourself into that place of being really, really hard. Last night at Spirit and Grace, I used on them a phrase I've been using on you guys. I told them we've got to start talking ourselves into a blessing instead of talking ourselves out of a blessing. Okay? And so Lisa was talking you guys into a blessing this morning when she was speaking from her heart of what she engaged with in over four spirit and graces that she has been a part of, and as she's entered into it, these are the things, and she's saying here, I want to have dinner with you. And so what, and knowing Lisa the way I do, what she's doing is inviting you to a very real part of who she is. And so when someone like Lisa asks you to have dinner with her, you're going to meet her on the road of a heart, not of just how is the weather. That's truth, isn't it, Lisa? Yeah. And that I can't tell you how much Lisa impresses me with her heart and the way that she speaks and moves and just moves in the power of the Holy Spirit. But that's the concept. And that's one truth upon another truth, which is leading us to a greater truth. And as we work through this mighty book of the Bible in Hebrews, it's just like these words are coming to life. They are words that have been recorded in Scripture, and often we just said them and we just didn't really understand what they were. Do you remember the Sunday I asked you what it looked like for God to rest? Like, Christians have been saying that for 4,000 years, like, be Jews. But I've stopped, and every person I've asked that question to, they kind of look at me kind of dumb. The other day, I was told what it looked like was God kicking back on a cloud. That might be your version of rest. And I said, did it look like God was puffing up the pillow behind his back? Like, was that... And it seems like ridiculous, but you've got to actually put yourself into the Scripture and into the words and start understanding what they actually mean. And because when you start doing that, all of a sudden the value and the life of this truth upon truth upon truth shows to you there is an abundance that God is calling us into, and it's not just a word. I've heard Christians say for 30 years, I want to have an abundant life. And the question I want to ask that, well, what does that look like to you? And most answers you get are a life without problems. And I say, well, that's just denial. That's not abundance. That's denial. What I have discovered, that even in my trials, there is abundance. And to me, that's a new vein of gold that I have discovered and I'm taking hold of. And I want to see where God leads it. Because even through all the things that we are going through right now, with all the things in community, I know that God is doing something that's irreversible, that is just plain brilliant, and is going to lead us as a church into this community, into greater places of abundance. I am talking myself into a blessing. And I think it's just Scripture. It's just taking the words, understanding what the words are, and building one truth upon another truth, which leads to a greater truth. And before you know it, you've found Jesus. I did a thing last night at Spirit and Grace where I invited people to imagine Psalm 23 and to walk through that place and to finally just imagine what it looked like at the end of Psalm 23, where it's got the feast table where you sit there with the king in full view of your enemies and you're enjoying your meal. And I asked people to imagine that table. Now, after the time, I was talking with people and every table was different. Every table was different. Why? Because every one of us is different. Our imaginations are different. And so when we're reading something in Scripture, often we're just reading it and going, okay, that's what I imagine a feast table to be. And so one guy I spoke to, he said, it's just two-seater table. Is that your feast table? It was his, and that's cool. To another person, we saw a feast table that was too long to see the end of it, and there was food over all of it. That's a lot of food, right? That's a lot of food. And so here is this place of abundance, and that's the way it looked. I had a woman come up to me after the time, and she's been a Christian for many, many years, and she says, I am yet to get a word from God. Can you give me a word from God? And that's a lot of pressure. Could have said just about anything and just said it's a word from God, right? And so I said to her, what's your table look like? And she told me. And so I said to her, what this table represents to me is a woman here of compassion and a woman here who loves the Word of God. She just starts crying right there on the spot. She knew it. She just wanted to hear someone say it. And all it was taking what was already inside of her for her to verbalize it, for someone to speak into it. And before you know it, they're hearing God speak. You can do it. It's not too hard. Right? If that makes sense. So all I'm doing is taking one truth, leading it to another truth, into a greater truth. And this scripture today that we're looking at in Hebrews chapter 7 is all about grace. Now, if you read Hebrews 7, 8, and 9, it's like you're in a Groundhog Day. Do you know that movie where it starts everything again? It's like you read one chapter, then all of a sudden the next chapter is about grace. The next chapter is just about grace. And he's saying the same thing time and time again. So when you'll see when next time I preach, I'm actually going to be leaping forward a little bit, because it's just like, I can say the same thing. I can give you the same message 3 weeks in a row if that's what you want. Lily's okay with that? Ida's not okay with that. I'm going to go with Lily on this one, Ida. Is that all right? And so here is this enormous statement of grace and this great truth that God has brought to us. And here in the scripture, it's saying things like this: Christ is our King and He is our priest forever. That's a truth right there. He is our King, so He is our ruler. He is our priest, which means He intercedes for us. He has taken our sin away. He is our King and He is our priest. They are two truths right there. The next truth was this: the old order, which is the old law, the law of Moses, has been set aside. Now, if you go forward a chapter, you'll hear this. The old law is dead. It has a DNR written over it. Do you know what DNR stands for? Do not resuscitate this thing. The law is dead. Rest in peace, right? But we as humanity keep digging this thing up and trying to CPR it back into life. That's just frustrating because it's dead. And sooner or later, you've got to look at the clock on the wall and go, it's time. We're calling it. Time of death is. It's done. But here, it's saying here, the old order has been set aside, and the writer of Hebrews says this: it's weak and powerless. Now, if you said that to a Jew, you'd be called a heretic for saying that. That the old law is weak and powerless. But here's why it's weak and powerless: because this new one in Christ has come along, and Christ compared to the law means that the law is weak and powerless because Christ is all powerful, and the law is just a shadow of what Christ is. And we've got to start getting this into our brains. We've got to start hearing it and learning to hear it. And sometimes we've got to repeat it. And sometimes we've got to talk ourselves into it, because it's too easy for us at times to slip back into pathways of, I must have done something wrong for this to happen to me. Who's ever said that? I must have done something wrong for this to happen to me. Or here's another one: I can't believe I'm forgiven. I don't know how many times in Scripture it actually says that you are, but we in our wisdom, in our humanity, in our past, we just go, no. What are we doing? We're trying to get that CPR into that old law, because we just want to bring that thing back to life, because there's got to be some life still in it, because I still believe this sort of thing. And so here in the Scripture, it's going, no, it's weak, it's powerless. Don't go there anymore. We've actually set it aside. It's actually done. DNR, do not resuscitate this thing. You've actually got to start living in this place of grace, and it's new. So Jesus would say something like, it's like a new wine, and you can't pour new wine into old wineskins. And I've never tried it, so I don't know what that is or what that's about. But you can't do it, because if you try and do it, the old one's just going to tear apart. And there's Jesus saying, if you're trying to put what is new into what is old, it's not going to hold together. And before you know it, you're just going to have a mess. You're not going to have this beautiful new wine that Christ is saying to us. Let's go back into the New Testament a little bit further back into the book of Mark, and there's two events in the book of Mark that I want to speak about this morning to show you the way that our humanity tries to go back to old patterns and paths. And these are the disciples, the very ones that hung out with Jesus, right? So one day Jesus sails across a sea, and the Bible says that when he gets to this to land, he steps out of the boat and his heart fills with compassion. We know that story as the feeding of the 5,000. His whole heart fills with compassion. The feeding of the 5,000 occurs in every gospel. Do you understand why it would occur in every gospel? So if something is that important and then something is that monumentous, there's four guys that just go, been there, was there, ate there, loved that, and I just got to tell you about it, right? There's four times that we hear about the feeding of the 5,000. In the book of Mark, Jesus gets out, and you know the story. You hear me say the story enough. It's just like, we're going to feed these people, and disciples can't be done. Okay? They're thinking the old patterns and the old ways. Jesus is doing miracles. Jesus is doing great things, but he hasn't fed 5,000 people yet, right? He's been feeding 12 maybe, but he hasn't fed 5,000, and that's a lot of people. And so the disciples go in their statement of unbelief to say that's impossible. And Jesus says, well, what have we got? We've got this small kid's lunch. And effectively, the disciples stole this small kid's lunch. How would you be if you were that small kid? But that's what my mum gave me. And I'm the only one here who's thought to bring food. He had his own little feast happening, and then he had none. That sounds sad, doesn't it? Anyway, you know the story. Jesus blesses it. He prays over, blesses it, breaks it, feeds 5,000 people, and then some. And there's 12 baskets of leftovers after that. I love leftovers. In fact, I store them in my fridge until the point of mold. Praise be to God for Tupperware. Not. Anyway, side issue. 12 baskets of leftovers. Does that sound like an abundance to you? And what did it come from? A small boy's lunch. That's a new thing. Now, if you were there, would you just be sitting there going, are we serious? I just saw a small boy's lunch become an utter banquet and feast. Would it change my world? And it probably would have rocked your world at the same time. Anyways, a short while later, Jesus is again with another crowd in Mark chapter 8. And it says, at that time, another large crowd had gathered and people ran out of food this time. So they actually brought food this time, but that ran out. And I'm sure that would be pretty easy with 4,000 people, right? I reckon food would run out pretty quickly with that kind of people. And Jesus called his disciples and told them, I feel sorry for these people, which means his heart filled with compassion. They have been here with me for 3 days and they have nothing left to eat. If I send them home hungry, they will faint along the way, and some of them have come a long distance. And so the disciples responded in which way? Do you think they said, do it again, Jesus? Just do it again. You did it before. Do it again. No. So we don't know how much time. It could be weeks between the two. They said, it's impossible. If God does it once, he can do it again. If you can declare that over your life, if he does it once, he can do it again. If he's done it for Claudio, he can do it for Trish. If he's done it for Trish, he can do it for Jan. If God does these things, if he's done it once, he can do it again. This is statements of belief. So Jesus says, what have we got this time? And they go, well, we've got a few bread rolls. They should have caught on. There's so many similarities. And I don't know who counted up the people, but the difference between 4,000 and 5,000, I couldn't estimate that. Like last night at Spirit and Grace, we had over 200 people there, I think. But if it went to 300, I don't know. And that's only 200 to 300. I can't imagine 4,000 to 5,000 people. Somebody had counted it. And still in the same place of unbelief. So where are they? They are still in the old way of doing things. This is the way that our humanity at times thinks. We slip back into old patterns. And Jesus is calling us out of unbelief and into belief. Jesus says, what have we got? Well, we've got about 7 bread rolls. And so they searched a bit more. Hey, we found a few fish. That's enough. Didn't say that they stole it from a young kid. They just found it. I don't know where you find fish and still think that's going to be okay. But they did. And so anyway, Jesus breaks it and does that. All he does, blesses it and breaks it and sends it out. This time they have 7 baskets left over. 12 for the 5,000, 7 for the 4,000. I don't know if any mathematicians here, if that actually works. It probably doesn't. But is Jesus slipping because he's only got 7 baskets left over? I don't even know how big the baskets were. Everyone's like, wow, this is awesome. This is unreal. And Jesus, like, the new way. This is the new way. And this is where I'm calling it to. Anyway, at that very moment where everyone's high-fiving each other and going, praise God, the Pharisees turn up. And it's like the Pharisees always turn up just too late for dinner, don't they? They're complaining about Jesus having dinner with other people because they're not at the table. They turn up after the feeding of the 4,000 people and all they've got is criticism and they demand something of Jesus. Do you remember a couple of weeks ago we got Melchizedek who invites Abraham and blesses him. Then the king of Sodom turns up and he demands something from Abraham. It's like the Pharisees have turned up to this dinner and they've missed out. Don't you hate it when you're too late for dinner? Don't you hate it where you just go, hey, where's all the food gone? It's in the fridge, it's in Tupperware, it's got mold on it, just heat it up. Too late for dinner. The Pharisees there, they demand a miraculous sign. Now, you got 4,000 witnesses that have just seen a miraculous sign, right? And it's not good enough for the Pharisees. They want to see it for themselves. Where are they? In a place of utter unbelief. They cannot believe that Christ is who he's claiming to be. They cannot believe what 4,000 people would say. Now, if you had 4,000 witnesses come to the front of this church and just tell you time and time again exactly the same event, what would you be doing? You'd be believing that event, would you not? I would be believing that event. If I wasn't there, I'd be wishing I was at that event. And wherever Jesus was going to be next time, I was going to make sure that I was going to be at that event. Because he has this habit of turning water into wine. He has this habit of making little bread rolls into feasts and all that kind of stuff. I just want to be hanging out with him, but not the Pharisees. Because they're in the old way and they're still thinking this possibly can't possibly be. And their unbelief has been given, they've taken the DNR off it. And they're actually trying to bring this back into being. And before you know it, they are walking unbelief. Now here's what it does for Jesus, and I want you to hear this, because when Jesus hears that they demand a miraculous sign, Jesus' heart sighs. Now when you sigh, you're not there in joy, you are discouraged. So here is Christ who has just fed 4,000 people and this miraculous thing, and everybody is praising God. He comes up against this group of people who are in complete unbelief and they're demanding something else from him, and there is Jesus. It's like the air's been taken out of his tires. And that challenged me when I read that, because at times when I find myself in unbelief, I feel like I'm taking the air out of Jesus' tires. Do you understand the power of what unbelief does? Story goes on. So Jesus walks away from that. And if you'd been a part of that and you'd just seen 4,000 people being fed that way, I don't know how long it takes for it to wear off you as to when you just go, okay, what's next? But there's Jesus, and he gets into a boat with his disciples. And you can hear in Mark chapter 8 that Jesus' mind is still back on that shore with those Pharisees. And the Bible says that Jesus said to his disciples, "Beware the yeast of the Pharisees." Unbelief has this habit of spreading. Unbelief has this habit of killing your faith. And he says, beware the yeast of the Pharisees. And it's like Jesus has been infected or touched by it, and he can see his heart and it's hurting. And it's this, and it's just like, beware what they carry, because if you hang out with them, that's what you're going to start carrying too. The disciples though, and so again, the disciples going, well, what's he talking about? Sounds a bit cryptic. Beware the yeast of the Pharisees, do they carry yeast around with them now? Like, is that how it works? And I've got to beware of what they're cooking. Anyway, in their brains, and this is how cryptic it gets, they get to this place where they go, oh, well, we know what Jesus is saying. He's asking if any one of us have bread. Does that make sense to you, how you can yeast the Pharisees? It's Jesus' way of saying, has anyone got any bread? It's probably not the way I'd say it. If I wanted bread, I'm not asking you about the yeast of the Pharisees. I'm actually telling you, you got some bread, Victor? Can you give me some bread? Debbie, you got any bread? I'm not saying beware of the yeast of the Pharisees, but I'm hoping you understand what I'm actually saying right now, and you can interpret my brain right now to say, I actually want some bread. And Jesus' heart again sighs. They're still not getting it. Jesus is there. This is the new way. This is what he does. This is who he is. But the human ways of thinking take us back to patterns of the past, and we can't seem to break ourselves out of the patterns of the past. And the pattern of the past for so many people is unbelief, that they cannot believe that this grace is as good as what the Bible is actually talking about. They cannot believe that the abundance of life looks like it can be found even in dark valleys. They cannot believe that the abundance of life can be in the strongest struggles of your life. They cannot believe that God is still at work even though everything is going pear-shaped. They cannot believe, and you hear it, I can't believe it, I can't believe it. Well, maybe we should start turning our conversation around and say, I'm gonna believe it. Because this thing of grace that we speak about, now the Bible here in this passage of Scripture talks about how that gives us a confidence to experience intimacy with God. Now if you've got an older translation in there, it says draw near to God. Okay? Intimacy is the drawing near of two people. And when I say the word, it's not just that I sit beside Trish, it's my heart connects with her heart. It's like Lisa saying, I want to have dinner with you. What she's saying, I just don't want to eat with you. My heart is going to be connected to your heart. And before you know it, we're going to be drawing near. And this is what grace actually speaks to in this passage of Scripture. God wants you to draw near to him. If you go to the book of James, it says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Be intimate with God and God will be intimate with you. You have a relationship that doesn't look like a contract. You have a relationship that is framed with these brilliant words of love and righteousness and blessing. The great truth that I found in this passage of Scripture, though, for me, is that unbelief has to die so that grace can flourish. Your unbelief has to die so that grace will flourish. And so if I sit beside you and I hear your heart and I hear of the guilt or the shame that you are racked with, and I keep speaking into you that you are forgiven, sooner or later, that's going to take hold. And sooner or later, grace will flourish. If you hang out with people that just want to condemn you, that's what will flourish. That's what will come out of your mouth. And that those times, like with the disciples, that's the things that came out of their mouth. I can't believe this is going to happen. I can't think of how that's going to occur. I can't see why that guy was born blind. I can't understand that's for the glory of God. And these statements of unbelief keep flowing. And it's like it's been spoken to Jesus in these passages in Mark chapter 8. You see how much it affects him. One of the reasons I love Spirit and Grace so much, and it's like someone said to me on Friday, it's like going on holiday spiritually. Because you can actually just be unhindered, as what Lisa would say. And we say, why can't church be like that every single Sunday? Well, maybe that's where we're heading. I don't know. But it's in this place where you've got a couple of hundred of like-minded people who don't know you from a bar of soap, and you can just be whoever you want to be, which is you, right? Isn't that cool? I remember when I first started raising my hands in worship, I felt condemned, not by the church, but I was just going, am I looking like an idiot right now? Am I full of myself right now? And like when I'm at Spirit and Grace, it's just hands up in the air. It's just hands up in the air, right? And there's even a dance happening. I'm not very good at it, but you know what? No one cares. I'll tell you something funny that happened last night. The team that I was working with, they're from Georges River predominantly, and they've got a very high level of musicianship. And for me, I don't. When I slot in with that, you can see the struggle between us. Because they're saying, play that. Oh, okay, I'll try. Just do this. I'll try that. Now, when I lead worship, as all these people up here know, the second time may not be different, may be different from the first time. And that's not because I intend it, it's just because that's the way it happens. And so when I get in the moment, like in spirit and grace, so like what happened last night is they did a first set and I did like a second set of songs and they with me, and I just take that guitar by the handle and just go for it and you just press in, and all of a sudden, like, you just go, whatever the practice is, we're just, that's just practice. We're actually going to do it for real now. And so in the rehearsal, that's where everyone gets frustrated because they don't know where we're coming in or why don't we, let's just let the Lord work that out for us. And that's just not a good enough phrase for some people. But so here in this place, I just go, well, I'm not as good as that. So what I'm going to do is just bring who I am. And so when you bring who you are, all of a sudden God does some great things. And there's nothing against what they do because they are awesome, awesome church. And I just love their hearts. But it's just how different things are when you try and start plugging in like that. But it's just cool. So last night at one point, and I just love this, and I'm going to share this, Zach, because you're just awesome. But at one point, the worship leader from George's River comes over to me while I'm playing my guitar and I'm just about to start a song. And she says to me this. She goes, I'm feeling led that Zach is going to prophesy. Do you know how much Zach loves public speaking? He would rather go to the dentist than public speak, right? And so I've looked at her, and like we're in front of everybody, and I've looked at her, and I've gone, because I've only just met her too, and I said, my Zach? And she goes, yeah, your Zach. I said, prophecy on the drums? And that's exactly how the conversation was going. She goes, yeah. I said, well, you call it, right? You bring it. And I turn around, and because Zach was behind a cage like this, but was even more, he could not hear anything I was saying. And I just looked at him and I said, mate, heads up. Here it comes. And so she gets up in front of everyone and she says, you know, tonight, Zach is going to prophesy on the drums and Zach's eyes are as big as dinner plates. I'm going to do what? This is what this church, it just engages with it so well. And so, and she goes, and he's just going to prophesy. And so I start leading the song and I say, okay, are we okay with that, church? And all of a sudden you got 200 people applauding and all the eyes are on Zach. No pressure at all. And so we do that song, Oh Praise the Name. You know that one? Praise the name of the Lord on high and all that sort of stuff. And in that song, there's an instrumental. And when we got to that instrumental, I said, okay, Zach, just take it off the chain and let's just do it. And Zach just starts going nuts on the drums and it sounds wonderful. And we get to the end of that and I say to Zach, no, we're going to do that again. And before you know it, he's lost the focus of every single one around him and he just starts playing. And people start telling me afterwards that they were so moved by what God did through the drums just because he was willing to step out and just be who he is. And in that place, you have somebody who has discovered the new ways of doing things and you just don't want to go back. You want to stay in that place. But at times, it's easy to slip back into those old patterns. It's easy to get shy. It's easy to walk away. But we have a Jesus that just continues to call us into the newness of the grace that he has given to us. And he's saying, stick with me, stay with me, and you're never going to miss the meal. You're going to be there when the 4,000 are fed. You're going to be there when I walk on water. You're going to be there when I raise the dead. You're going to be there when I speak to the poor. You're going to be there when I touch a leper. You're going to be there when I declare the gospel out. That is what it is to feast with the King, one truth upon another truth. And this is the grace that he has given to us today, that he is calling us into, and he's declaring it is so good. Please don't go and DNR. No, don't do that stuff with the law anymore. Come to a place of life. Declare the place of life over you today and step into this new place that we call grace. If you have struggles today with guilt or shame, stand up and declare that you are forgiven and believe it. You are putting your unbelief to death. If you are in a place where you fear what's going to happen, stand up and start declaring over yourself that fear has no authority over your life because Christ is your King and he leads your life and he rules your life. Is that right? Today, I call you as a church into grace. again, and you're going to hear me say it again and again, and you're going to think I'm a broken record, but this is the place that God has called us to, and He's breaking the old patterns of the past so that we can leave them dead in the ground and we can start living in this place that we call abundance, that is found in every avenue and area of your life. It's not just found on Sundays. It's not just found at Spirit and Grace. It's not just found when you're alone. It is found in every avenue, every area, whether you are by a still water or whether you are through a dark valley. It is found there, and He's saying to us, stick with me, even when it feels impossible. Stick with me. This is the intimacy that this passage is talking us about, and it's saying this, that you have the confidence to experience intimacy with God, which means you have the faith to believe that your relationship with the Father is growing. The Bible says in verse 22, all of this magnifies this truth. When something's magnified, it's getting bigger. Can you hear grace getting bigger maybe this morning? Let it get bigger today. You guys ready to pray? Father in heaven, we just thank you for today. We thank you that you are here, and we thank you for all that you are doing. And Father, today I pray that grace again, this message of grace will be laid upon us. And Father, we know that you've forgiven us for our unbelief. But Lord, we want to be like the man in Mark 9 where he says, Lord, I believe, but help me with my unbelief. So Father, help us just bury it. Help us, it's dead. Let's just let that thing die so that grace can now flourish. And so, Father, I pray again that we again be known as a church where grace flourishes, and when people walk into this place, grace flourishes. I just thank you, Jesus, for each person who's here and what you're going to do in their lives today. In Jesus' name, amen. So may the peace of Jesus be with us all. May it be over our lives, may it be in our lives, may it be pouring out from our lives. And I pray, Father, that today others will come into the presence of you through the peace that we carry. So, Father, bless the time that we spend downstairs in morning tea. Let conversation abound, let hearts be open, let love flow. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
And it is well with me.